another talk about open contract by Tamira, and she also had a pre-recorded video, and we are going to watch a video, and after the video we are going to have a open discussion, and she will join us remotely on net. And the talk for this section is 921363. So can have a switch to the talk by Tamira, and I don't want to talk much because she's going to introduce herself and
herself. Hello everyone, my name is Amina Salazar and I am the media analyst at the Open Projects Partnership, and I'm going to talk with you today about how can we use open procurement data to monitor emergency procurement. So to start, and I'm going to share my screen, I wanted to give you a bit of a background about what I'm going to be speaking today. So governments around the world spend around $13 trillion a year procuring everything from medical equipment, masks, to bridges, highways, and school meals. So it's one of the biggest markets around the world. Governments, the OECD estimates that a third of government spending goes to public contracts. However, it is the number one government corruption risk. So at the Open Contracting Partnership, which is a global NGO, we work with partners around the world to think different about procurement and using an open government and open data approach to drive impactful and sustainable reforms. And we work in different areas. The first is working with governments to help them publish and use and improve open contracting data. So we have a data standard for that that I'm going to present to you in a minute. But we also work with different key stakeholders, government agencies, civil society, media organizations, in order to use this data and also drive impactful reforms that could improve the lives of citizens. And we work more currently in more than 25 countries around the world using this approach of open data plus open government to transform public contracting. And we have documented different impact stories on how this approach has actually helped governments and citizens around the world. And during the emergency, actually procurement became one of the key topics. And if you think governments around the world were fighting and trying to figure out how to procure the different goods and services that were needed to attend the emergency, there was a massive supply and demand shock. And also, since a lot of governments were using emergency procedures that tend to be weaker and it totally makes sense to use them during an emergency, there was a widespread use of these methods that also led to some misspending and corruption cases around the world. In July, the study we conducted, we estimated that at least $100 billion had been spent on pandemic-related procurement, so there has been a huge amount of money destined to attend the emergency, and we're going to see more of that coming now that we are approaching the recovery phase and also the procurement delivery of possible COVID vaccine. So the question here is, how can we monitor emergency procurement? How can we monitor this huge market and this huge amount of money that goes through public spending? And I wanted to start with and ask you if you could answer some of these questions. That might seem quite simple, but that you might not be able to answer that easily. So for instance, if you think how many contracted procedures since March or since April started relating to the COVID-19 emergency, how much money has your local government spent in this items? Do you know, do entities know reference prices, to know what is the best price they can get for a particular service? Were there problems with the delivery of these items, etc.? And these are simple questions that, unfortunately, if you don't have structured data, you might not be able to answer them. So this is where one of the products that we support comes into play. It's called the Open Contracting Data Standard. And this is the standard that relies on three principles. One is about open contracting, that is this idea that I've been discussing about transparent and fair procurement for everyone. It's also about open data, so this idea that data should be structured in a machine readable format and made available for everyone to be able to access. And it's also a data standard in the sense that it tells you how can you structure information what data fields to publish and how to publish them. OCDS was designed around four different use cases. So cases related to value for money and efficiency, to integrity, to effective service delivery, and also to level the playing fields for businesses in order to guarantee better competition and inclusiveness. And OCDS, the core idea behind OCDS is that you can structure data and describe the procurement process through the different stages. So if you have a single procurement process, let's say you want to buy a mask, then you can track this procedure from planning when the entity is planning to buy this item, then through tender to award contract, and then during the implementation and delivery phase of that contract to see if, for instance, those masks actually were delivered to the right hospital. And then you're able to track this information using a unique identifier. So in practice, how this works is that if you're an entity and you have a procurement system and you collect different types of information, then you can map that information into the data standard and then disclose that information as open data for everyone. And the standard also provides guidance on how you should structure this data. So for each of the stages that I mentioned, there are particular data fields that you can prioritize and that we suggest you should publish if you want to serve the different use cases that I explained. So for instance, you can publish data fields related to values, to bidder information, to the contract, to the payments, to the delivery of those contracts. And all of this is in a documentation that we support and also provide the technical support governments or civil society that wants to publish data using this type. And in practice, this looks something like this. We currently have around 38 publishers worldwide that go from national governments to subnational governments, so with countries, let's say like the UK, that at the national level, they publish contracts, that in some other countries, let's say in Argentina, they are like the city of Buenos Aires, which is the capital, they publish data in the city. And we have different examples of countries in all the continents that are publishing OCDS data. And during the emergency, as I said, a lot of the contracting procedures were emergency contracts, and in some cases, this information was not necessarily going through the e-procurement system, so there was not an obligation to publish this contract. So what we saw is that a lot of the publishers that were actually using the standard, they were able to tag those contracts easily and also publish and disclose that information in open and structured formats. So now that you know a bit about the data, then how can you actually use it to monitor and what type of analysis you can using this data? The first thing I would say is that you need to define what you want to measure, what type of indicators you want to track. And this can relate to red flag, to efficiency indicators, to competition. It will really depend on what you're trying to measure and the problem you're trying to address. And once you are clear about that question, then you need to map the data fields and identify the data fields that you will need to measure and answer that question, and then of course, go and analyze. And I wanted to show you some examples of what type of indicators you can calculate and also how have our partners in the field use these indicators to monitor emergency spending. One of the common indicators that are really relevant in this context is red flags. The red flags relate to are indicators that indicate suspicious behavior in procurement. And the idea of red flags is that if you are able to track and monitor this indicators, you can actually spot and prevent corruption before it happens. So you can, for instance, identify particular red flags and then be able to monitor and more quickly look into particular contracts that might seem suspicious. So here's a list of some of common red flags related to emergency spending, but we also have guidance on our website with a red flag guide that contains around 150 red flags that you can map to the data standard and calculate related to procurement. In practice, how does this look and how have our partners used this information? So for instance, we recently worked with 12 researchers around the world that were interested in investigating emergency procurement. And this is one example from Buenos Aires, from one of the research teams that explored price deviations. So one of the questions he had in his research is that he wanted to know if the city government was buying emergency items at higher prices than in the past. So this is the first step, as I said, defining the question. And then what he had to do was to map and identify what data he needed in order to answer this question. So he needed historical data about procurement, so which entities had bought particular items. So we also needed item detail data, unit prices, and what procurement methods were used. And luckily, in websites, as I said, the government published structured data in the Open Protected Data Center. So it was data that was structured and available, so the analysis was easy to use. What did he find, and how can these findings be used? He segmented, he selected 16 emergency items, and he actually found that 39 of those 16 items, the median and average price was higher during the emergency month four. So he was able to identify in which items this was happening, in what types of procurement methods it was more common to see this price difference. And then based on these findings, then he was able to do recommendations to the procurement authorities in order to see how can we avoid this in the future or better structure our public purchases so that we can avoid this for future emergencies. Another great example of how can you use open structured data to monitor is in Ukraine, and I totally recommend you to see the Ukraine example. We have documented it also on our website. Is that they have a ready procurement system, and they disclose basically all the information as an open and structured format. And with this information, they're able to build different monitoring and business intelligence tools to track. So this is just a screenshot or of one of the platforms, monitoring platforms they have, where you can actually track in real time the median price of particular emergency items. So everyone who's interested can go to this dashboard and check in real time what prices are the end of paying for this item. Similarly, in Paraguay, one of the projects we supported created a civic platform where they took all the open and structured information and then disclose it in a more friendly and user-friendly format so that users can actually see how much money was being spent, track historical prices of particular items, and identify also suspicious relationship between suppliers that you could actually report in the media or investigate further. Another example of a red flag, as I said, is about inexperienced suppliers and cases of governments and entities that buying to inexperienced suppliers was common during this emergency. And this particular research done by the Anti-Corruption Institute in Colombia, the objective was to identify multi-purpose suppliers. And these are suppliers that, let's say, in the past they were used to selling school meals, and all of a sudden during the emergency they are selling medical masks and medical equipment. So they might have a higher corruption risk. So they developed an index in order to identify these type of suppliers so that control authorities could identify them more easily and then investigate further if needed. So in this case, also in Colombia, the data was open and available in a structured format. So this research team was able to collect this data about past suppliers and then data also about the suppliers that were awarded during the emergency. And the result is that they found that around 30% of the suppliers that procured entities during the emergency, they could be cataloged as multi-purpose firms. So 30% of these suppliers could have a higher corruption risk in Colombia. And this was featured in the national media and showcased to all the country, all the findings in the national media. And another similar example was in the case of Georgia, where similarly data was collected for all these emergency purchases. And Natalia, the researcher, she found that half of the total value that went to companies with no experience in public procurement, including many recently formed companies. So this is these were examples of how actually procurement entities were contracting entities that suppliers that might not have the best experience to provide these goods and services. So these are just examples to give you an idea of what you can actually do with the data. But in case you want to know more, on our website we have different resources depending on what you're interested in. So in the case if in your country, in your local government, you do not have a human data available, we have a guide on what data you can collect, publish, and visualize during, most related to this emergency, but then you can, it can be relevant as well after the emergency and to monitor for human data. So this is a guide that is free and available on the website. Also, as I said, if you want to know more ideas on how to monitor procurement, we have this guide, this research report that, as I said, includes some of the research that I mentioned before about emergency, investigative emergency procurement around the world. So it's 12 different examples from 12 countries that investigated more than a million contracts around the world. As I said also, if you're interested in red flags, we have a guide that contains a detailed guide on what red flags you can calculate and then what data you need to calculate those. So that's a resource that is also available. More importantly as well, we have a free global help desk, so you can ping us at data@opencontracting.org, and our help desk can help you with all the technical questions you might have related to structuring data in the open contracting data standard. And also, if you want to analyze procurement data, even if it's not in OCS, we have a lot of, as I said, resources, methodology, and we can help you with ideas on how you can analyze procurement data. So these are all the resources available that we have on the website. And hopefully this was helpful. So you can see my contact information there. Please visit our website where we have, as I said, a lot of resources. And I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you, Camira, for her presentations, and she's in the meeting now to answer any question from the audience, so you can use Slido to raise your question. Yeah, I think it's very, very a lot of information, but I think the organizer, we are going to hand out the slider and any materials she provided to all participants, so don't worry about that. I also encourage you to have a look about OCP's website. A lot of materials, very useful information about how to conduct open contracting, how to collect data, a lot of material applications, a lot of case studies. It's very, very resourceful website. Yeah. Give you 1 or 2 minutes to refresh and have your question answered. Can you see your question on Slido? Yeah. I just repeat the questions. Do the company resist this kind of control or data monitor, such as they will say, we don't provide the product if you are doing this price control? Curious about companies. I think open data is focused on government side. So if the tenders, the company, and they want to participate in the procurement of government procurement, anyway. The second question is the pattern of corruption you are finding very much across the world, or is this